So first off, I want to take a look at your readings. Okay. I noticed that our record holders are here lah, kan, the maximum number is 10 times, which is Wilson and Wilson. Okay. Some people didn't make it past six. I think on average everybody did about seven or eight throws lah. Okay, before you finally got zero. Okay, but that's not so much as important as the graph. Okay, so the first thing that we need to know is that the half-life decay, the decay graph lah, okay, or the decay curve, okay, is a reciprocal curve. Okay, they are like graph salingan. Okay, so it should look like this shape. Okay, any one of these shapes is fine. But you find that, and I noticed that not everybody did what I asked you to do, which was to, oh, sorry, which was to jot down, okay, like what is the number of throws, okay, when the number of tails is 30, and what is the number of throws when the number of tails is 15, lah. Okay, so in this case, let's take a look at Jacinta's, lah. So Jacinta did. Okay, but actually it's not one. I know why you wrote one. Okay, because number of throws, but kind of number of throws, that kind of 1 point something. But okay, fine. But the idea is this: there is always a starting point. Okay, and the starting point over here is what we call an initial, initial number. Okay, let's start with this one. Kita pastikan yang kita ada the correct terminology first lah. So number one. There's always a starting point where we call it an initial number. Before the decay starts happening, this number over here is how many tails there are left. Okay? And then remember, half-life is the amount of time it takes for the number of tails left, to become half of its original value. So half of 60 will be 30. Okay, so the time over here, okay, actually, kalau ikut, if let's say we really follow coordinates lah, this will be about maybe 1.2. Okay, 1.2. And then the next one is not to go from 30 to 0. Remember, this is not an arithmetic progression. It is a geometric progression. So we have to go 30 and then we divide by 2. And that's why I asked you to count 15. Okay, so from 30 is 1.2. From 15, you get 2.4. Okay, according to this graph, is 2.4. And that is actually the thing that I wanted you to see, is that the amount of time, let's say this number of throws, let's change it a little bit. Let's say that the number of throws represents the number of hours or the number of minutes. Okay, bilangan minit lah. So if let's say every throw represents 1 hour, therefore, the half-life for Jacinta's particular experiment, is about 1.2 hours. And we find that the next one is also the same because 1.2 plus another 1.2, this will be 2.4. And so by extension, half of 15 is what? 7.5. 7.5 is somewhere here. Okay, you should get about 3.6. Okay, and so on and so forth. So this is the idea behind half-life. Okay, we need to know what is the initial activity and the time it takes. For 60 to go to 30, for 30 to go to 15, for 15 to go to 7.5, going by half, by half, by half. According to the decay curve, the amount of time is the same. So one of the most cantik one, actually, well, for me lah, okay, one of the most cantik one, with the exception of this part, okay, is actually Jacinta's graph lah. Okay, because here is 1.2, here also is another 1.2, very nicely drawn. The curve also is quite nice. Now, the only difference between our experiment and the half-life curve, the actual decay curve, is that the actual decay curve will never reach zero. It will actually go on until infinity. Like, you just continue to go less and less and less, but it will actually never touch zero. So, dia akan sentiasa berbahagi dua, berbahagi dua, berbahagi dua. Okay, they will always half, 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 half. But of course, this is our experiment, and definitely you have to continue until you get zero, lah. Okay, that's fine. Okay, another graph which I thought was pretty interesting Okay, let's take a look. Sorry, hold on. So Jacinta's one is about 1.2. Okay, let's have this in mind first. Jacinta's graph, her half-life is about 1.2. Bear that in mind, lah. Okay, now let's take a look at Rania's one. Okay, let's not even, no comment about the shape or anything, lah. Okay, but let's take a look. Okay, so originally there's 60 over here. Okay, and then she had about 30 and then here, lah. Okay, now again, let's assume that every square represents 1 hour. So you find that her decay curve is 0.8. And then the next one from 30 to go to 15, this is a little bit longer. Okay, it could be because of the way that she drew the graph, or it could be also because this is an experiment. So definitely there is going to be a little bit of error over there. Okay, but the idea again is this. Okay, the idea behind this, now why I'm doing this comparison is that you take a look at, let's assume kita anggap yang Rania's graph, her this one is 0.8. Do you remember Jacinta's one just now? Jacinta's one just now is 1.2. Okay, do you notice the difference between these two graphs? Let me zoom in a little bit more. Okay, you notice that if the half-life is bigger, okay, the curve is even more compared to if the half-life is smaller, like Rania's is 0.8. Okay, so her curve is much less. But Jacinta's one, her half-life is bigger, 1.2. A bigger half-life means that your curve is even more. Okay, an even bigger curve. Okay, let's choose somebody else's that has a very small half-life. Okay, let's take a look at Shafiq's one. Okay. Okay, Shafiq's is about 1. Okay, and his is also quite consistent. Except that I don't know what happened down here, like bullet night where you I don't know how you go from here and then they bullet night, but never mind, let's not talk about that. But okay, so 30 is here, so okay lah, fine, about 1.1. okay, and then 15 is here, about 2.1. so you find that his curve, his half-life is about 1.1, which is about the same size as Jacinta's one. Okay, so it's a little bit wider as well, lah. I need to choose somebody who has a very small half-life. Hold on. Because actually most of you, your half-life is all around 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So it's a little bit. Okay, let's take a look at Oswald's one. Oswald's 30. Okay, so you see Oswald's one, Oswald is less than, his is less than 1, lah. Okay, so you see that the graph is even more curved, but Oswald used a different, Oswald used a different this one. Actually, Rania's one is one of the ones that is very small half-life. Everybody's one is mostly 1. Okay, Brandon's one, let's take a look at Brandon's one. Brandon also has the same as Jacinta's, so it's 1.2, and then but a little bit inconsistent lah. Okay, this is 2. So, dia punya jarak tidak sama. By right, actually, dia punya jarak sepatutnya sama. Okay, the selang masa untuk dia menjadi separuh, the time it takes to become half, okay, it's actually supposed to be about the same. Okay, let's see Wilson's one. Oh, yeah, Wilson and Wilson have. Okay. So, you see Wilson's one? So, Wilson's one has his half-life. His half-life is very small. Okay, his half-life is only about 0.4. From 60 to go to 30, okay, it's about 0.4. And from 30 to go to 15 is, oh no, it's not even 0.4. Oh, okay, he did 2, sorry. Okay, fine, sorry. So this is 0.8. Okay, 0.8. And then this one is about 2. Okay, but actually it's supposed to be what? It's supposed to be 1.6 lah, kan? Because the amount of time it takes for 60 to go to 30 must be the same amount of time it takes to go from 30 to 15. And likewise the same. So sepatutnya, this should be about 1.6. But again, this is experiment. Okay, we never want everything to be perfect in experiment. Otherwise, it's not really good. And let me see if I can see Wilson's one. Where is Wilson? Okay, let's do it at Wilson's, because Wilson also had 10 tries and he also did the for the same thing. Okay, so 60 to go to 30 is about 1 point. Wow, what's so big one? 1.8. Okay, and then from 30 to go to 15 over here is about 3.6. So you see, Wilson's one is a little bit more consistent. Okay, his half life here is 1.8, and then another 1.8 is 3.6, right? So it's about here. So Wilson's one is quite consistent, although the graph looks a bit funny. Okay, it looks a bit funny. Okay, but anyway, the idea behind this is this lah. Okay, I want to show you a few concepts based on the half life graph. Number one, the word initial, okay, the starting number. Okay, and then after that, remember that every half life is supposed to be the same amount of time. Okay, supposed to be the same amount of time it takes to go from one to half of it, and then to half of that to half of that. So it's supposed to be consistent. So people like Wilson and just now Jacinta, okay, quite consistent. Okay, 1.8 and then after that 3.6. And just the other one was 0.8 and then after that 1.6. So pretty consistent. Okay. But okay, thanks everyone for, well, thanks to 23 people. Okay, 23 people who have sent this. Okay, so there's only 3 more people left. All right. Let's go to what we're supposed to continue doing today, which is, so this is where we are at. Okay, this is where we're at, and we want to talk about how to determine the half-life. So again, remember that this N naught over here, okay, is the number of nuclei. Sorry, N, this one represents the number of radioactive nuclei, which when you did the experiment, is the number of tails that were left. So originally, you had 60 tails, okay, and then after the first time you shake, and I don't know how you shook it, okay, once you go from 30, 60, then you go to 30, that amount of time that has passed is called the half-life. And by extension, when you go from 30 to 15, okay, that amount of time is already 2 half-life. So masa untuk sini dengan sini sepatutnya sama. Okay? And then and so on and so forth. So there's initial, there's half, and then there's half of the half, and then there's half of the half of the half, and so on and so forth. And as I said just now, the graph must never reach zero. It will actually just continue to go on to infinity. It will never actually touch zero because it's a geometric progression. Okay, as it gets less and less and less, it will get less and less, but it will not touch half. Okay, so a radioactive substance will experience random and spontaneous radioactive decay. So the reason why the time is consistent, okay, is because it's very difficult for us to predict. We cannot, setiap kali di decay, terus kita ambil bacaan. Okay, we can't do that with a radioactive substance because it's so inconsistent, it's so random, it's so spontaneous. The only thing that is very sure, that we can be very sure of, is the amount of time it takes to get to half of its original value. Okay, and again, and I mentioned this before, this is why it is under modern physics. Okay, it cannot be explained classically, because classically, when we think about classical physics, we think that, oh, okay, lepas 60, 30, lepas 30, kosong lah. So, tolak 30 bahkan. Okay, but that is not the case. Okay, in this case, there are some things that even Newtonian physics cannot explain, and this is one of those things. And it is very well explained by modern physics. What is going on inside the nucleus that causes it to decay so spontaneously and so randomly? Okay, until yang kita boleh menjadikan ketetapan hanyalah masa untuknya menjadi separuh. That's the only thing that we know for sure. Okay, so the number of nuclei which has not disintegrated decreases with time. So different radioactive substances decay at different rates. Okay, so a decay rate, okay, can be determined by a decay curve, which is what you did lah. Okay, so, and as I explained just now, somebody with a higher decay rate, somebody with a higher decay rate, that means dia punya masa sangat singkat, okay, dia punya kadar decay, masa dia sangat singkat means dia cepat mengurai, it decays faster, okay. So you get a more flatter graph. If you have a lower decay rate, it means you take a very long time to decay. Okay, it's called a lower decay rate, but the time is longer. Okay, to remind you once again, that rate and time are not the same. Okay, if the time is bigger, the rate is smaller. So, but they're faster. Okay, that's why when we're doing comparison questions, be very careful when we're talking about rate. Okay, always go with the words bigger, smaller, higher, lower. Don't go with faster and slower. Because I've seen this time and time again, everybody say, oh, higher decay rate means bigger. Okay, but actually bigger is slower. No, higher decay rate is bigger, correct lah. Okay, but when you're talking about the time, okay, it takes a faster time, it is a smaller amount of time. Okay, higher decay rate means faster, but we don't write faster. Okay, we always write higher and lower. Okay, so the shorter the half-life of the radioactive sample, the higher the rate of decay. Okay, or the time is smaller. Okay, bila masanya sangat kecil, dia punya kadar penguraian adalah sangat besar. Okay, and we studied this, and I just showed you this method just now lah. Okay, how do you determine the half-life? Okay, is by using the graph. So you have the initial activity, 300. Always look for the initial activity. If the initial activity is 300, then you know half of 300 is 150. So then you down here, then this is the half-life. Whatever time it is over here. And then just to verify, do a second time. 150, half of 150 is 75. Okay, so you find 75 over here, then you mark down here, and then you see, you should see that the amount of time here and the amount of time here should be the same, which is the half-life. Okay, so that's how we determine half-life, by using graph. Okay, so again, this is 800, so that's the initial. 800 divided by 2 will be 400. So the amount of time is 55 seconds. From 400 become 200. Okay, when we go over here, it become 110 seconds, which is same lah, 55 seconds also bakan. 55 plus 55 is 110. So by extension, from 200 to go to 100, 110 plus 55 will give you 165 seconds. The moment you know one half-life, you can figure out the rest of the time really. Actually. Okay? So this is an example of a decay curve for the radioactive gas radon 222, okay, which has a half-life of 55 seconds. Means every 55 seconds, half of it will be left. Okay? I repeat, setiap 55 saat, tinggal separuh lagi daripada yang asal. Okay? But it doesn't mean that tiada reputan, terus boom, terus jadi macam ni, tiada. Look at the graph. It goes less and less and less and less over time. That means in the 55 seconds, dalam masa 55 saat itu, dia sudah mula mengurai lah. No? It already starts to decay. And the only thing we know is after 55 seconds, tinggal 400 lagi. Okay, there's only 400, duit shilling left lah. Fine, duit shilling lah. Okay, we're going to use the example. Okay? And the experiment that you did now is kind of like a proof for that, I think if you repeat the experiment 10,000 times, you will still get the same outcome. It's pretty amazing if you think about it. Okay, why is it that, and if you saw the table just now, I noticed that everyone, almost everyone, after one time you shake, it becomes half already. Okay? And that is something that mathematics can explain lah, but it's a very long-winded explanation. But I think it's very amazing when you think about it. Bukan satu dua orang yang begitu kau. Satu kelas, almost everyone in the class had the same outcome, which is the first time you shake you're left with half immediately. Okay, why isn't it that one time shake then somebody only less than 10 lah, some people dia kurang sebanyak 20 lah? No. Almost everybody, they got about 30 to 40, pieces left. Some even less. Why? Have you ever stopped to wonder why one time we shake already become like that? Why? Okay, it's actually explained. It's actually an again an example. Oh, this is probability lah. Okay, etc. 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 But it's still pretty amazing when you think about it lah. Okay, there is no one in the class that one time shake oh dua saja berkurang tiada. Okay, everybody half. Okay, berkurang. All right. So let's take a look at this example question. It's just an example, so we'll do it together. So always mark down the initial activity. That's what you need to talk about first. Okay, so initial activity is 1,600. Half of 1,600, you need to mark down the 800. Half of 800, you need to mark down the 400. Half of 400, you need to mark down the 200. Because we are going by halves. Okay, kita bukan pergi secara konsisten lah. Tolak 800, tolak 800, tiada. It's half, 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 half. Okay? So the half-life of the radioactive sample, you take a look, from 1,600 to become 800 is already 25 minutes. Okay, so it will be 25 minutes. Okay, so the question is, what is this value of T over here? Okay, so 400 is here, right? 400 is here. So this is one half life. This is two half lives. And so this T will be the third half life. So 25 minutes, 25 minutes over here is 50. So add another 25 minutes over here will be 75. Okay, and that's our answer. So when you understand how the decay curve works, actually it's very simple. And it's very simple, but you know, like with everything, sometimes something so simple, so people will forget lah. So try not to forget lah. All right. Continue. Well, everybody has knocked it down for me. Okay. Now, this is another one. Question 7. All this is in your module, by the way. Okay, what is the half-life of the sample? So same thing. Okay, set the initial activity, 1,600. Half of it is 800. Okay, so the half-life will be 25 minutes. Okay, so over there. This is the same question as just now. Okay, fine. 75 minutes. I'm not going to waste time. Let's go to this. Okay, same thing. Original is 1.2. Half of 1.2 is 0.6. Half of 0.6 is 0.3. Okay, never mind. Let's just leave it here. Now determine the half-life of radioactive Q. Okay, so 1.2 to 0.6. 0.6 takes us 15 minutes. So that's the answer lah. Okay, the half-life of radioactive Q will be 15 minutes. Show in the graph how you determine the half-life. So how you determine the half-life is actually by starting from here, then colocis garis putus putus, putus putus putus. You can draw arrows lah if you want. Okay, but either way, this is how you would show it. Okay, remember, show in the graph is a very common question. What is the number of radioactive nucleus that has not decayed after 25 minutes? So you want to find 25 over here, and you are left with 0.4. Okay, why is it time? Oh, times 10 to the power of 6. Sorry, times 10 to the power of 6. Okay, that's over here. And since this is a number of radioactive nucleus, okay, number is bilangan. So we don't need to, there's no unit lah. Okay, there's no unit involved here. Okay, calculate the percentage after 45 minutes. Okay, so since it is 15, right? 15, that means 15, 30, 45. So there's, zero. So there's one half life. There's two half-lives, there's three half-lives. Okay, so we're talking about three half-lives. So kalau percentage, how do we start? If it is percentage, we always start with 100. Okay? One half-life will be 50. Two half-life, 25. And three half-lives will be 12.5% left. Okay, itu yang tinggal. So for since our half-life is 15 minutes, so 45 minutes will be 3 half-life. The 3 half-life, 100 to 50, 1. 50 to 25, 2. 25 to 12.5, 3. Okay? So that's how you get 12.5 is left. Okay, last one. So determine a half-life radioactive sample. Okay, so at 10 January is 1520. At 20th January is 380, and then at 30th January is 2021. But you cannot say 10 days. Sebab, cuba kau tengok, 1520 bahagi 2 berapa? Bukan 380 kan? Okay, so we have to rewrite the whole thing. Okay, so initial activity is 1520. Divide by 2, you get 760, I think, yeah. Then you divide by 2, it'll be 380. So you see, from 1520 to go to 380 is 10 days, 10 January to 20 January. So how long will it take to go from 1500 to 760? It'll be 5 days. Okay, so the half-life, fine. The half-life will be 5 days. And even if you tidak puas hati, you can go all the way to 95, like you do the same thing. Okay, so it'll still be 5 days. So based on that, you can sketch the radioactive decay of the curve. Okay, it's a very simple sketch. Okay, you just draw 1520 and you just mark down the 760. And if you want 380, like also can. Okay, but actually just 1520 and 760, as long as you show that there's 5 days, okay. Sorry, time slash days. Okay, so 5 days, 760 is fine. Okay, if you want 380, okay lah, fine. This one's okay lah. Then you just draw a curve and remember that it must not touch zero. Okay, it should not touch zero. All right, let's continue. Okay, so the concept of half-life. So besides using, manually and also besides using the decay curve, okay, we can also use a formula. Okay, and this is the formula, and this is given inside your textbook. So the number of nuclei that has not decayed after a certain half-life is half to the power of n, which is the number of half-life that has already dilalui, okay, times the initial activity. Okay, the initial number. So let's say in this case lah. Okay, so our initial number is 1520. Okay, and the half-life is, let's say how many half-lives, right? Let's say you want to find out after 1, 2, 3 half-life. Okay, so n equals to 3. So you can count. Okay, n equals to half to the power of 3 times 1520. Okay, and when you do this on your calculator, you should be able to get 190. Okay, you'll get 190. So, this is very simple. We use this formula when we don't have to know what is the half-life. We just know how many half-lives there are. Okay, so since we know E-E-Sana, we want these 3 half-lives. Okay, so you put the number 3 over here. This half is standard. Times the initial activity. Once again, everybody, I'm repeating this word again and again so you remember. Initial number, initial activity, yang asal. Okay, now for those of you who get this, okay, those of you who understand this, this is actually a step up from your geometric progression, ARN-1. Okay? Your A is your initial activity, your R is the common ratio, and the N-1, because our 1, okay, our 1 is over here. Yang pertama ini adalah sini. That's why we don't need this minus 1. Okay, so ini yang pertama. Okay, those of you who understand can carry on with this. Those of you who don't, just ignore what I just said. Okay, but I just wanted to mention this because I think it's worth looking into. Okay, the fact that actually the decay series is a geometric progression. That's why we cannot 800, 400, 0. No such thing. 800, 400, 200, 100, 50, 25, 12, 25, and so on and so forth. Okay, there is no end to a geometric progression. Right? So the idea, the activity of a radioactive sample is directly proportional to the number of radioactive nuclei present at the same time. Bila kita cakap pasal bilangan radioactive nuclei yang ada dalam nucleus, we're talking about the activity of a radioactive sample. Okay, now this word activity is something new for us, okay, because whenever we think about activity, we think about, you know, activity sukan, activity memancing, activity melancong, not that kind of activity. When we talk about radioactive activity, is how much more, okay, radioactive samples are in, sorry, radioactive nucleus is in that sample. Okay, at that time, the activity of a radioactive sample is the number of decays per second. Okay, namely, the number of radioactive particles emitted per second. Okay, so in physics form 5, actually in physics form 5, we use the word activity and number of radioactive nuclei quite interchangeably. Okay, dia adalah benda yang sama tetapi disebut dalam cara yang berlainan. Okay, the activity of the nuclei, okay, you know, is a representation of how many nucleus, sorry, how many radioactive nucleus there are left. Okay, so this is in your textbook. So initial condition is this, okay, and according to the formula, we can find this. Okay, so the change in the number of radioactive nuclei in 5 half-life will be like this lah. So the orange represents the radioactive nuclei that has not decayed, and the white has represented the ones that have decayed. Okay, so this is all the activity. This is the activity 8, 4, 2, and so on and so forth. Okay, so let's take a look at this. This is another question, number 5, I think. The table shows the count rate recorded from the radioactive substances two different times on the same day. So you want to find out what is the half-life. Okay, so 2 p.m. to 5:40 p.m., you have 340, and then go to 85. Okay, so we always start with the activity, because the activity always actually helps us. So we start with initial is 340. Okay, let's go half. Half of 340 is 170. Half of 170 will be how much? 85. And we have reached the 85 already. So how long was this altogether? From 340 to 85, how long did this take us? Okay, it took us 3 hours and 40 minutes. But the question is not asking for how long it takes. The question is asking for half-life. Half-life is how many half-life? 2 half-lives. Okay, so you have to 340 minutes divide by 2 lah. Or you can also say it's 220 minutes lah. Okay, 220 minutes, but that is 2 half-lives. So one half-life will be 220 minutes divided by 2, which will take us about 110 minutes, 1 hour and 50 minutes, okay, for the half-life. Okay, so, yeah, there are many ways to count this, okay, you can use the curve, you can use, you know, manually one by one. You can also use the formula, okay, which we will see in this next one, okay, also can. Activity sample X becomes 6.25 the original value up to here after 120 minutes. Means from here all the way to here is 120 minutes. Oh, sorry. Minutes. Okay. So how many half-lives are there? 1, 2, 3, 4. It means each half-life is how much? 120 divided by 4. So it'll be 30 minutes. Okay. Now, the ratio of nuclei argon-40 to potassium-40 in the sample of volcanic rocks is 3:1. Okay, let's just read this first. So in the early formation of rocks, there was no argon element trapped in it. Now, if potassium-40 decays in argon-40 with a half-life of 1,250 million years, okay, estimate the age of the rocks. Now, this is a very interesting thing. So, so again, the key word here is this. In the early formation of the rocks, there was no argon. That means it is all, you know, potassium. Okay, it is all potassium. Selepas beberapa ketika, dia sudah menjadi 3:1. Okay, dia sudah menjadi 3:1. So, we have to take a look at it as the number of potassium-40 nuclei that has not decayed will be initial activity. Originally, everything is potassium. Then when it decays, it becomes argon. Okay, so the number of argon here is zero, so there's no ratio lah, because they are TAA divided by zero. Now after half, okay, after one half life, the number of potassium becomes half, okay, and the number of argon also becomes half of the this one lah, okay, the activity. Because N naught minus half N naught will give you half N naught. So this to this, the ratio will be 1:1. Okay. Now half of this will be 1/4. Okay. So if it is 1/4, how much has already become argon? Okay. This will be the original one minus the 1/4. So you're left with 3/4 naught. And this will give us the ratio of 3:1, which is the one that is given in the question. Then you stop here. Then you say that, oh, okay, this amount of time is 1,250,000 years. And since there are two half-lives, okay, therefore, the age of the rock is 2,500 million years. Because already one half-life is 1,250,000 years. So two half-lives means for the rock to mencapai this ratio, 3:1, it would have taken 2,500 million years. Okay, for the rock, from all the potassium 40 to become 3:1 ratio of potassium to argon, argon 40. Okay, and this is how we estimate the age of rocks. We have to look at, of course, we have to know what is the half-life first. That's number one. Secondly, we have to look at how much is the ratio. Okay, we look at the rock, then we see, is there any radioactive element in there? Okay, and then the radioactive element, because usually the radioactive element will be inside the rock. Okay, and it will, and when it changes, when it decays, it becomes something new. So what we learned that after alpha, beta, and gamma decay, right, it becomes something else. So there's going to be a certain ratio over there. Okay, memang akan ada satu ratio. And so when we look at the ratio, we look at the half-life, we can determine how old a certain rock is. Okay, and this is the basis for this field. Okay, this field in science, which is called geology. Okay, how to determine the age of rocks, how do you, how are rocks formed? You know, these are processes that happen over many millions of years. Okay, and it is a branch in science. It's true. Okay, a lot of people think that geology yang tiada kaitan dengan science, bahkan people think it's pasal batu saja. Jadi ia adalah pasal geography. See, that's not true. Okay, there are a lot of universities which offer geology as a major. Okay, under the science faculty, it is a science. Okay, dia ada pengiraan, dia ada experiment, dia ada lab. Okay, and a lot of it has to do also with radioactivity lah. Okay, so yeah, that's one way lah. All right, so this is an experiment which unfortunately we don't have time to do. Not that we don't have time, we don't even have the materials to do. But this is how to study the half-life of a radioactive sample. So over here, you have a radioactive source. So I'll talk the radioactive source over here. And this is a GM tube lah. So a GM tube, the function of the GM tube is to detect, okay, the activity, okay, of a radioactive sample. Okay, so it's just detecting the activity of a radioactive sample. So when the radioactive source, you put it there, then it starts to decay, okay, so the GM tube will give us the reading. So the rate meter, okay, the GMT will give us a reading, and it will give the reading will be shown here lah. So the rate meter is taken every 10 minutes. Every 10 minutes kita ambil bacaan, the activity of the sample is calculated exactly like what you did. Okay, and the results of the plotted the results are plotted as activity against time. So we know that when we plot a graph of activity against time, we will get this kind of graph. It will touch the y-axis, but it won't touch the x-axis. And then from there, we can determine what is the half-life. Because the mass of the radioactive source, kita sudah tetapkan. Okay, let's say you put over here 10 grams lah. Okay, fine. So 10 grams, macam tu. Okay, and then after that, they will calculate lah. You can calculate, okay, the rate meter means how many grams yang sudah decay. Then you can calculate. This calculation is not shown here, but you can calculate to find how much activity is left. And you plot, exactly like what you did with the coin thing, okay? And then after that, you can determine the half-life, okay, from the decay curve. So basically what you did, okay, was an example, okay, of what they did. Except that this particular part, this second one, okay, is something that you didn't do. So kamu kira, I mean, the only thing you did was just count how many tails there were. Okay, but actually there is a calculation behind this, which we won't go into at this period in time. Okay, but just to show you how the experiment works. All right, so for your class tomorrow, please complete the tutorial 6.1. Okay, so not many questions, I think. Yeah, okay, the tutorial 6.1 has about 13 objective questions and, 5 subjective questions. Yeah. Okay, so I know that time is a little bit short, but try to complete as much of it as you can. And tomorrow we'll discuss the questions.